James.
Bill, Matthew, speaking of betrayal, one of the problems for the Tories is they've been beset by scandal, and now just days out from an election, they've got another one. The Times have revealed that a number of Rishi Sunak's inner sanctum have been caught placing dozens of bets on the timing of the election, including his personal protection officer, another key advisor. This just feeds into the narrative, doesn't it, that the Tories have had one rule for the country and a completely different rule for themselves.
Well, look, this is classic Tory behaviour. They're putting themselves and the party ahead of the country, and many voters can sense this. But there's also a deeper question here with regard to Rishi Sunak and his administration. Remember, Rishi Sunak has no mandate. Okay, so viewers who are not familiar with British politics might not be aware of this, but he was never elected to become leader of the Conservative Party. He was appointed, right? So that's a really, really important point. And then there's the mission, the vision. What does Rishi Sunak stand for? He came in after Boris Johnson was turfed out. He did have a mandate, by the way. Liz Truss was turfed out. She had a mandate. Rishi Sunak was brought in by the Tory elite class, who said, we must get the adults back into the room, a.k.a. technocracy, managerialism, the same old bland consensus that we've had for years that voters rejected through that Brexit referendum. And here's my question. What was it all for? What was this for, this project, this installation of Rishi Sunak? What has he actually given the country? He's given us the highest tax burden since the 1950s and 60s. We've got the highest rates of legal migration that we've ever had. We've lost control of the borders. Illegal migration is completely out of control. The British Tories have mainstreamed woke ideology. They've got kids being taught that boys can become girls, that girls can become boys. We've got critical race theory in our primary and secondary schools. We're importing a lot of that nonsense from America. But look, conservatives are supposed to stand up against this stuff. And so every time Rishi Sunak has been in front of voters during this election, the voters have increasingly said, actually, I don't like that guy. That guy's not really for me. Why is this guy even prime minister? I don't get it. And let me tell you, there's one thing briefly that everybody will remember about this election campaign for years, decades to come. And it's this. When Rishi Sunak decided to leave the D-Day anniversary early, he went to France for a few hours. And then against the advice of some of his advisors, he left the anniversary early. And that raised a much deeper question in this country, which is, does this guy even believe in Britain? Does he really believe in our history, identity, culture and values? And that, too, has been an enormous open goal for Nigel Farage, who has understandably kicked a load of footballs into that open goal during this election campaign.
But one thing, Matt, as well, that Nigel Farage pointed out was it wasn't just Rishi Sunak. Last year, apparently, Keir Starmer had his poppy on during the morning when he was attending various events. And then when he attended an Islamic event, the poppy mysteriously disappeared. And Nigel Farage asked the BBC interviewer whether this was a sign that maybe Keir Starmer as well had didn't quite know the significance of D-Day. Just tell us briefly, Matt. So Farage's attack net zero, which is fantastic. COVID vaccines, he wants to look into that. Lockdowns, masks, he wants to look into that. Migration is the big thing. He's prepared to tackle trans ideology. These are all the culture war issues that so many politicians on the right have avoided for years and years. He is a cultural warrior. What do you think will happen between now and the election? Will the Conservatives, idiots like David Cameron, who isn't even elected to Parliament and is criticising Farage, will they come around and start to see that they need to maybe split the seats somehow, do some kind of deal, or is that not on the table?
In brief, there will be no deal between the Conservatives and Nigel Farage. Why would he make a deal when he thinks, understandably, he can win the whole House?
Yeah.
And that's what he's thinking. Not necessarily, of course, at this election. Remember, we're in a first-past-the-post system. But here's what Farage is hoping. He wins a handful of seats in 10 days' time. Maybe he wins 5 million votes. Maybe he wins 100 second places. Maybe he is the alternative to Labour across all of those working-class districts. Then he comes out of the election, he says, right, now I'm going to take over what remains of the Conservative Party. And he invites all of those disillusioned Christian Conservatives to join with him to build a new political movement in British politics. This is where it's all going. This is going to be an incredibly bumpy, volatile, chaotic period in British politics, which I hope will get us to a much more representative and successful Conservative movement that's more in touch with the people, because what we've got at the moment cannot continue. This is a joke of a Conservative Party that is simply not Conservative on any major issue at all. It's completely and consistently given way to Liberal progressives on a whole host of issues. And so Farage, stronger than ever. That's the conclusion from this election.
Fantastic. Matt Goodwin, so great to have you on the show. I hope you will join us on that bumpy road ahead many more times, because it's great to have your insights and your knowledge there. Thank you for staying up so late to chat to outsiders, and have a great day tomorrow with Nigel Farage.